that say you want to tell me another story again.
My loving Plateau people, this is Zoomlens 4 and I remain your servant Jones Lanibedley. I'm not trying to blow the whistle but to share my clinical opinion on the state of affairs in Plateau State over the past 2 years, vis-a-vis the governor's 5-point policy thrust. I want to start by congratulating the governor and his team for manning the state for about 2 years. And to my Plateau people, happy Democracy Day. I sincerely wish to commend the rescue team's peace-building initiative and the Peace and Conflict Bureau, though ineffectual, the gradual reawakening of the Highland Bottling Company, Breaking Lady, the resuscitation and transformation of the Plateau State University through the handiwork of Professor Atahiru Jega, the construction of major roads within and without the metropolis, the massive improvements in water supply, and so on. The administration of Governor Lalong came on board May 29, 2015, with a mandate to liberate, redeem, and deliver Plateau people from the shackles of violence, tribalism, poverty, and underdevelopment. To achieve this, the governor meticulously articulated a 5-point policy thrust, viz. Peace, security, and good governance, human capital development and social welfare, agriculture and rural development, entrepreneurship and industrialization, and physical infrastructure and environment. The rescue team has done remarkably well in restoring relative peace in the state. There has been a dramatic change in response rates by security operatives in the states to potential conflict zones. This has restored citizens' and investors' confidence. As for good governance, on the fateful day of October 15, 2016, major roads around the golf course were barricaded because the governor was golfing, depriving law-abiding taxpayers access to go about their normal businesses. Is that good governance or executive rascality? On human capital development and social welfare, the team has been outstanding and has distinguished itself. Outstanding in empowering family members, in-laws, and friends through inflated contracts. What the Plateau people jointly fought the immediate past administration for that precipitated the birth of this administration. Outstanding in ensuring key federal and state positions go to people who are mostly of a particular ethnicity or consanguineous link. Outstanding in appointing wildcats and experienced sticky fingers in key offices. Outstanding in social welfare schemes, including donating Prado SUVs and Toyota Camrys to National Assembly members from Plateau, costing 48 million naira and 27 million naira each, respectively. Outstanding in social welfare of 1 million naira to the Plateau State University Students Union government during the convocation to chant Say Lalong 2019, Babatu Tenor. Outstanding in appointing an invisible 170 special assistants as 2019 campaign forerunners. Outstanding indeed. On agriculture and rural development, the rescue administration claims to have procured 39,800 metric tons of farm inputs available to farmers at 50% subsidy. No wonder agro-contractors on the Plateau become multimillionaires in a split second. The Commissioner of Agric stated at some point that she was yet to formulate any blueprints to run the agric sector in the state and made known the inexistence of a certain number of farmers in the state. The Deputy Governor last month validated that by stressing the need to create a farmers' database for effective policy formulation, regulation, control and monitoring. After 2 years in office, the Agricultural Services and Training Centers, ASTCs, established by the Jiang administration have been reduced to shadows, forcing workers to be idle. No silos or crypts have been built, nor is there any radical agricultural policy on ground. Rural development, of course, remains a forgotten promise. On entrepreneurship and industrialization, we now have a small and medium enterprise development as well as a state microfinance development agency that are so active and productive on paper. The imaginary Simon Lalong Entrepreneurship Scheme has painted a beautiful picture of empowering 2,889 women and youths in the state. They were allegedly trained for 4 months by the state microfinance agency in partnership with Apurimac Nigeria. The CEO, who was with Apurimac Onlus, and the Governor's Associate, and the Just Entrepreneurship Academy, owned by Inde Ezekiel Gomos, who runs virtually all contracts in the state and mans the state's Entrepreneurship Development Agency. efforts to reach a single benefactor soul proved abortive. So I'm forced to ask, what were the selection criteria? What was the starter packs given? How much was expended? Were there loans or grants? Why wasn't it publicized for a wider pool of applicants so their credentials could be verified? Are we sure we're not empowering ghosts or rent seekers with specific focus on taxpayers' monies? His Excellency would rather engage in largesse, private jet trips for people that have done nothing, confer awards with gifts worth millions of taxpayers' monies, than invest in the likes of Dusu, who has exhibited innovativeness in constructing a tractor and needs encouragement in further training that could result in industrialization and jobs. On physical infrastructure and environment, not noteworthy. But at least members of the rescue team, their siblings and cronies, are erecting super iconic structures all over the city. Look at the city of Jos. In a time of ravaging diseases like cholera, malaria, typhoid, meningitis, etc., our rescuers would rather table millions or billions for committees to tackle the pandemics caused by their ineptitude than prevent it. This administration has been attentively inattentive to the tourism sector that has the potential of pivoting on development and industrialization in the state. Rayful Resorts is just a barricade stopping people from free fresh air. The Pandem Games Reserve is in shambles and under threats of deforestation and poachers. Animals at the Jos Wildlife Park are unfed and unkept. No wonder lions are escaping in search for survival. Look at the lounge and restaurants. They don't even have or know what a menu is. Am I being critical of the rescue government? Nope. Look at the manifesto and show me an area of achievement. On tourism, they promised to develop and fully explore the tourism potentials in the state, especially in Wasi, Pandam, Madu, and the Jos Wildlife Park in line with global standards. They promised to remodel the Solomon Lar Amusement Park and construct multi-purpose children parks in all three senatorial zones of the state. The rescue team promised to ensure the completion of the Rock International Hotel. They promised to remodel the Pangshin Hilltop Hotel along the model of Obudu Tourist Resorts. On finance and budget, they promised a transparent and prudent management of resources, an annual publication of state audited and expenditure accounts for public accountability. None seen so far. On environment and urban governance, they promised a repositioning of the Jos Metropolitan Development Board and the Plateau Environmental Protection and Sanitation Agency. They promised to build new parks, gardens, reforestation and city greening. They promised an effective waste management system through public-private partnership and successfully deceived us during campaigns with cleaning of the metropolis. The rescue team promised a remodeling of the city master plan to address industrial and housing layouts. On youth and sports, this team promised the establishment of a youth commission on the plateau. They promised youth empowerment programs. They promised the establishment of skill acquisition centers in all 17 local government areas of the state. The repositioning of the Plateau Youth Council. And we can go on and on. The recycling of the same old politicians by the Lalong administration is a clear indication of a lack of clear agenda. Plateau youths, our future as the future of the future is being mortgaged by the recycled politicians who never tire of sucking us dry, and they're referred to as political juggernauts. We must try to bring an end to this monolithic, styleless style of governance. How can the same people who have contributed passionately immensely to failed past governments be called back to rescue us, saying they are experienced? Oh yes, experienced sticky fingers, experienced election riggers, experienced satisfiers of key stakeholders that control the masses. Plateau youths, analog people cannot solve digital problems. We must demand accountability. We must secure our tomorrow today. Plateau youths are not good enough for key positions. Not a single youth in the cabinet. Even the youth ministry is manned by a grandpa who is over 60. No youth heading a single parastatal, but we are good for thuggery, campaigns and snatching of ballot boxes. Even the Plateau Youth Council election was controlled by the so-called elites. We had a governor's candidate, a minister's candidate, and so on. When will Plateau youths have their own candidate? A candidate that will salvage and rescue us from unemployment, poverty, infrastructural deficits, tribalism, and God for that reason. A candidate that will truly be accountable to the people, because Plateau needs rescuing. Pitiably, that rescuer is not here yet. It sucks seeing youths antagonizing each other on social media elusively along party divide. Plateau youths, there are no parties. What we have is the base and the superstructure, the proletariat and the bourgeoisies, the haves and the have-nots, the rulers and the oppressed. There is no APC versus PDP, only the opulent, flamboyant politicians versus the religious and tribalistic poor. APC is at the helm of affairs in the state. Look at the governor, a former speaker under the umbrella. His deputy, a PDP Guba candidate 2 years ago. The APC chair held a number of juicy offices in the PDP government. The chief of staff, head of Good Luck Neighbor to Neighbor, who only dumped the PDP after defeat and a week to the Guba election. And over 80% of our appointees were PDP members. We must unite and eschew thuggery, mediocrity, sycophancy, and hate, so that together we can build a promising future that concerns us. Recently, the SSG told the House Appropriation Committee that 3 billion naira is needed for more exotic automobiles. In less than 2 years, our celebrated governor has embarked on at least 16 foreign travels. You don't want to know the cost. He goes to Abuja as though going to the bathroom via chartered Arik flights, costing taxpayers 3 million naira for a less than 15 minutes flight. This rescue administration has spent millions, more than any in the history of our dear state, to host music and all kinds of celebrities, selfies and parties. This government has commissioned underdone projects. The rescue government allegedly spent 400 million naira of taxpayers' money to organize the Just Carnival. The Lands and Survey boss, who was with JIB, sold plots of land belonging to the Just International Breweries around Golan Bays, a very strategic area for a tourist resort. And yes, he acquired a good chunk of it and built this. He has also allocated massive plots of land belonging to our state to his cronies around Lamingo, amongst others. Now we know why a lawyer and a journalist lobbied to head the Lands and Survey Ministry. On May 1st, His Excellency lauded himself for paying salaries and pensions and alluded to the inexistence of a divide between the leaders and the led, referring to civil servants as the led, forgetting the existence of a larger crop of enthusiastic, unengaged youths. A state that celebrates payment of entitlements is a failed state. Just look at the 2017 budget and show me one area of rescue. 2 billion naira for official vehicles. 1 billion naira for the completion of the Little Raithel government house that has swallowed 13.5 billion naira by 2015, an additional 1.5 billion naira last year, and an extra 1 billion in 2017. 1 billion naira for the procurement of security equipment that swallowed 750 million naira last year. 700 million naira for the renovation and furnishing of the House of Assembly complex that cost us 700 million naira to renovate and furnish last year. 100 million naira for building and furnishing of the protocol lodge at the Haipang airport that was allocated 280 million naira last year. 271.65 million naira for the rehabilitation of the state internal revenue zonal offices, while 158 million naira was allocated in 2016. 200 million naira for IDPs, 468.5 million naira for Operation Rainbow, 120 million naira for the construction of a fuel dump at the new government house, 150 million naira for the procurement of hardware and software for salary administration and payroll, 3.44 billion naira for the acquisition of local government election materials. This budget is preposterous, ludicrous, insensitive, as well as an insult to a state that is referred to as civil service driven. We respected and admired the rescue team long before they came on board. But at this moment, it will seem the mind we had so esteemed is outmatched by the rationalization of complacency, ordinariness, obsequious flattery, and largesse. Looking at the 5 points policy thrust and going by statistics of the past 2 years, we can only describe this administration as a political roller coaster, autopilot driven, and a violation of expectation. I'm not trying to condemn or write off this rescue project. I want to commend them, but at the same time, alert them that when you get an opportunity to do basic things expected of even a robotic government, like payment of salaries, and you manage to move an inch above the abysmal performance of predecessors in one sector, don't take bootlickers, sycophants, and praise singers serious. There was never an administration on the plateau that was devoid of praise singers, awards, and so on. Strive for excellence. Frugality must come into play. And this team should explore all areas that will make plateau an investor's destination of choice in Nigeria and sub-Saharan Africa. Your Excellency, the pictures painted by our MDAs are far away from true. We have successfully created avenues for heads to fetch money. Plateau is rich, not broke. Only the Plateau people are. Your Excellency, 2 more years, if put to judicious use, can rescue Plateau. But only if appointments that were based on patronage are reconsidered. We can't afford to politicize, tribalize, religionize, and familicize every position in the state. We need quality people with vision and passion that can add value to this administration and state. We need statesmen, not politicians. With the broccolis, potatoes, strawberries, apples, etc. grown in the plateau, PADP and ASTCs can go for a backward and forward integration that will lead to jobs. This is a multi-billionaire industry. The state water board remains stagnant and retrogressive, only in comparison to the Nigerian power sector, even with billions spent. But there's a way forward. PRTVC leaves nothing to be desired. If private electronic media outfits are operating 24 hours and recording profits, why can't PRTVC even sustain itself with the billions allocated yearly? Plateau is poor by choice. Quarrying and mining can industrialize this state and create thousands of jobs. Look at the exotic tiles, marbles, and granites produced in Jos with over 80% local content. This government should look into it. Waste management is an industry that can create massive jobs in Plateau. Ogun State is looking into waste to energy and waste to wealth. Sweden has run out of garbage. Let's look into it. This administration can save billions in costs by keying into the Dangote concrete road construction. 5 states in Nigeria have adopted it, and it's said to be cheaper, more durable, and has less maintenance cost. The rescue team should revamp the Plateau Express service and reposition it for better service delivery, revenue, and jobs. The government in the state should restructure and modify the psyche of the civil service towards productivity, prudence, and transparency. The Tourism Corporation should be awakened, as it has the potential to sustain the state, create jobs, and lure tourists, and consequently, investors. We should have a state museum and a tourism map. When all these measures are taken, no one will describe the rescue administration as a resplendent veneer, a mirage, a charade wrapped up in a facade, because the dividends of democracy will be so visible. To end, Your Excellency, we love Plateau, and that's why we don't want you to be just another statistic to the number of failed governments, and we will bring our ideas together to rescue Plateau. I appreciate your listening patience to these lines, and remain open to superior facts and filling of gaps in this documentary. Finally, Mr. Governor, as the good book says, walk with the wise and you will be wiser. Associate with fools and trouble will surface. God bless Plateau State.
all of the shady politicians. As you see me so,
don't be smarting.
I'm not send you.